This is the story of six women who came out of the South and changed America for good. The 60s and 70s were the golden age for this music, from the battlefield of marriage. Loretta Lynn, Blue Collar Queen, the coal miner's daughter who made a career of standing up to her man. Tammy Wynette, Soap Opera Queen. She sang of the hurt and pride of raising a family and standing by your man. And now you tell me Billy Joe's jumped off the Tallahatchie Bridge. Bobby Gentry, the Mystery Queen, who walked away from it all. Would you lay with me? Tanya Tucker, Wild Child, Tabloid Queen, who put sex into country. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Dolly Parton, who made millions singing of the world she'd left behind. But it was from the black and white world of the 50s that there emerged the trailblazer, the Queen of the Night.
Crazy, I'm crazy for feeling so lonely.
There was no one that could cry a song like she could. There was no one that could make you feel the emotion.
Crazy for feeling so blue.
To me, she was the greatest voice of that era.
These records hit me so hard. Something about Patsy Cline for a woman in the 50s was very progressive.
Patsy Cline, you can put shoulder to shoulder with Ella Fitzgerald and Frank Sinatra.
I never met another woman that could out-sing her.
She sells millions of records every year. It's unbelievable how many records she sells.
Patsy didn't just knock the door down, she kicked it in.
Got a feeling causing blues. Oh, Lord, since my baby said goodbye.
Patsy was a fighter, feisty, forthright and funny. You had to be to break through in 50s Nashville. At the Grand Ole Opry, Temple of Country Music, Patsy scared the life out of newcomers.
One night, I was changing clothes and that door popped open and it was Patsy. And she had on this cowgirl outfit. And she stood there with her hands on her hips. She said, well, you're a conceited little so-and-so. You just waltz in here and do your bit and waltz out. And I said, now wait just a damn minute. And we just almost had it right there. And she laughed. She said, anybody that'll stand up to the Cline is okay. So we're going to be good friends.
Patsy Cline, isn't she great?
You know, she was a good-looking, rough, rugged, one of the singingest people I've ever met. She would cuss you out just as quick as somebody else. And if you didn't like it, you know, you knew where the door was, and she'd tell you that.
Yeah, she could hold her own with a crew of sailors.
Patsy was born in 1932, in the depths of the Depression. There are reports of her being sexually abused by her father. It was a troubled childhood.
It was like she preferred not to go there, and I didn't ask.
When she was 14, her father left the family. Patsy dropped out of school to work as a waitress and a singer.
She's our special guest tonight from Virginia, and her name is Patsy Cline.
Patsy Cline, how are you, Patsy? Just fine. Nice to see you. And the bell rings with me now, Ernest. This is the young lady you...
In the 1950s, Nashville was very, very conservative, even more conservative than most of the nation.
The first thing was the church.
Women singers rarely headlined shows, and the industry assumed that women wouldn't buy their records.
The breakthrough of Patsy Cline was really a watershed moment.
We have a young lady that is fast becoming one of the leading sellers on phonograph recordings, Miss Patsy Cline.
I've loved and lost again. Oh, what a crazy world we're living in.
Patsy was just breaking into the music business when she met her second husband.
I asked Patsy to dance, and she said she couldn't while she was working. Later on, I seen her dancing with somebody else. So I went back and I said, "You said you couldn't dance." She said, "That was my husband." But then 1 week she showed up and her husband wasn't there. So I went back and asked her to dance again, and she did, and that was that.
They both had a temper. He said one time, "If I hadn't taken up for myself, she'd have killed me with a baseball bat."
I seen her knock the hell out of him with an iron one time. They'd have a little fight, and she would call, and the police would come out and arrest him.
They're just two crazy people having fun.
I go out walking after midnight.
Patsy was always on the road, always working.
Oh, I remember very much missing her when she'd have to leave. Kids cry and have fits, and I do remember that. I do remember that we weren't just waving by. It was very hard. I think that was probably one of the things that she really didn't enjoy about the business.
Now come on in and sit right down and make yourself at home.
Patsy came up the ranks singing good old hillbilly country, but now her producer, Owen Bradley, was pushing her towards pop.
From what I understand from Owen, she really saw herself as a hillbilly. She didn't want to sing pop songs.
She said, "I've always done Western swing and it's kept food on my table." I said, "Patsy, honey, you listen to Owen." I said, "You've got the talent, but he's got the ear, and he knows exactly what the market needs."
The Weeping Ballads won. This was something quite new, a sophisticated country pop sound.
She had this huge heartache voice, and they chose heartache lyrics for her because she could just about weep in tune. And then they would take and cushion the sound of her records with strings and made it a softer edged country music.
Patsy made quite a lot of records that were quite elegantly arranged and they didn't sound so country.
Patsy was taking country music into the city. She'd made the music modern. Her look was changing too, from cowgirl outfits to cocktail dresses. I Fall to Pieces was a country and pop hit.
But each time I go out with someone.
She might not have liked the song much, but she liked it being a hit.
She had no money, old car, and they were going to repossess her refrigerator. And she said, "Well, hoss, they ain't going to get my frigidaire now."
Do you ever cut anything but hits?
Well, I don't know if I can help it.
Oh, my. Prove it, girl. Prove it.
All right.
Crazy. I'm crazy for feeling so lonely.
Crazy, the number one jukebox hit of all time, cemented her crossover appeal. It's become her signature tune.
All Patsy Cline has to do is kind of just barely whisper crazy, and it's like, oh, not everything's moonlight and roses and falling in love for the first time with Prince Charming. Sometimes, you know, love is really horrible and it makes you feel like you're going mad.
Why do I let myself worry? Wondering what in the world did I do? Oh, crazy.
There was so much soul and life to her voice. She lived all the songs she was singing, heartache and love.
All the pain and trouble in Patsy's life came through when she sang these songs.
I'm crazy for trying, and crazy for crying, and I'm crazy for loving you.
It was all inside, and she let it out in those songs. Crazy. It was there for you to hear.
Great singers have some gift. You gotta believe that they've been crazy or that they have fallen to pieces or they've lived these songs.
Crazy for trying and crazy. for crying, and I'm crazy for loving you.
On the way back from a performance in Kansas City in March 1963, Patsy was killed in a plane crash. She was only 30.
I remember Dad waking me up to tell me that she wasn't going to come home. It's something you don't really understand at 4 years old, I don't think.
Sweet Dreams was released after her death.
Some of the songs are kind of sad. They have a lot of emotion in them. And I do like to listen to them to kind of feel close and to kind of to see what she was like. It helps you to remember a lot about them.
Instead of having sweet dreams about you.
Now no one could say that a woman couldn't top the bill or shift records. The blue-collar queen went a step further than Patsy. The coal miner's daughter sang her own songs, drawn from her own life. They were like bulletins from the front for her millions of listeners. Songs about sorting out your man.
Well, your pet name for me is Squaw. When you come home a-drinking and can barely crawl, and all that loving on me won't make things right.
Oh, Loretta Lynn.
I think that she's the greatest female singer-songwriter of the 20th century.
Here was somebody that was just as country as dirt and sang it like the women lived it.
Loretta had lived it by the time she was 13. Little bit quick there, but that's okay. She had the background to draw from.
Loretta was born poor in a log cabin in the Appalachian Mountains. When she was 13, she fell for the local bad boy, 21 and just back from the army, Doolittle Lynn, known as Doo or Mooney.
He drank a lot. Daddy knew that there was going to be some problems.
Her parents didn't want her to marry him.
Daddy told Doolittle, if you ever hit her, you know, that's it. But when you're away from your family, you don't know what's going on. She had a child right off. She was so young, she didn't know what she was getting into.
Just as her parents feared, Loretta, still just 13, was getting into a violent marriage.
And she said, I loved him, you know, all through it all, so. Most women that take the abuse like that from a man do love their husbands.
His drinking and womanizing would feed her songs. When Loretta was 14, she followed Doo 2,000 miles across the country to Washington State. By the time she was 18, she had four children and a guitar.
Mooney heard my sister sing and loved her voice. So he got the guitar. You know, he knew she had a talent. I know she would not have done it on her own if it hadn't been for Mooney.
Loretta won a local talent contest, which led to a TV appearance and a record, I'm a Honky Tonk Woman. They sent out thousands of copies to radio stations, but they weren't getting played.
They said, well, I guess the best thing to do is just hit the radio stations on the way to Nashville.
Brought two of the kids to our house and two of the kids to his mother's house, and then they went on the road.
Anybody that would talk to her, she would give them a picture and a record that they had made up.
So turn that jukebox with
her. By the time that they had got to Nashville, her song was in the charts, and that was unheard of at that time.
It was 1960, and they'd arrived in the capital of country. Loretta was ready to tell it like it is.
We did her very first sessions, and when we heard her sing, we couldn't believe it.
It wasn't long till all your dreams came true.
Loretta had the same producer as Patsy, Owen Bradley. He didn't push Loretta towards pop.
The first session that we cut with Loretta, I told my brother, I don't know what it is about that woman. Whatever's in her heart comes out her mouth. And he said, yeah, he said, I thought she was sincere. He said, that's why I signed her.
If you don't want to go to this city, you better detour around my town.
There's no schmaltz about her. There's no kind of like torch song kind of feel to any of it at all. It's very, very honest. She's fearless.
Looking back, sex didn't mean that much to me for a long time. What do you mean by that?
Well, if you don't know how, you just don't know how, right?
Yeah. Right. You don't know what to expect?
You really don't know anything about sex. You just, it takes you years to learn. I think it did me.
The dog is a-barking and the floor needs a-scrubbing. One needs a-spanking and one needs a-hugging. And one's on the way.
She's in a situation where she's got babies, you know, so write about having babies.
I hope it ain't twins again.
You write something that you know about, and that's what real writing is about.
Owen saw that the real Loretta had to shine through the songs, however it sounded.
I love the line when she says, the work we done was hard, at night we slept because we was tarred.
People would say, Owen, why didn't you change that? And he said, no, because that's Loretta.
Well, you thought I'd be waiting up when you came home last night.
Her best-known song was co-written with one of her sisters.
Some of the radio stations banned it because they thought it was a little dirty, but couldn't figure out why.
And don't come home a-drinking with loving on your mind.
Southern churches criticized them from pulpits. DJs really kind of raised their eyebrows and said, well, I don't think we can play this. Loretta's rise to fame parallels the rise of the feminist movement in the United States. Feminists recognized that this was somebody who was definitely sticking up for herself as a woman, and that very much dovetailed with the mood of the country at the time.
All these years I've stayed at home while you had all your fun, and every year that's gone by, another baby's come.
You told me that a doctor called you once and told you
he come to the show and come out to the bus, and he said that the pill really had done more for the country people that live way out in the country than the government had.
I think she broke down barriers for women like no other female singer-songwriter has done. I think her lyrics are brilliant. They're sly because she's just sneaking you with sort of catchphrases.
'Cause now I've got the pill.
It's a great way to do it. Sneak the medicine in the mashed potatoes, you know.
I relied more on maybe the subtle ways of saying things. Where I would maybe gloss it over and don't make my brown eyes blue. Loretta would do it in, okay, honey, I'm getting you. If you don't come home.
In 1980, Loretta's life story became an Oscar-winning film.
I went to the premiere of the show. Afterwards, I told Loretta, I said, you know, it's amazing how everyone else has changed to fit the world. You've made the world come to you, and you have never changed.
I lie here all alone in my bed of memories.
She's this little bird-like person with a really sweet voice, and yet she must be hard as nails because she's had such a life. She never deserted her husband, even when it was really difficult.
Du died 9 years ago. At 71, Loretta has just made a dramatic comeback, singing the kind of song she's always sung on a Grammy-winning album with Jack White of the White Stripes.
The intention of making that record was, let's get down to the soulfulness that's inside of her. But all the harshness on that record was all Loretta's idea, it wasn't mine. And she was the one who wanted to keep turning it up. And she said, I can't hear the kick drum, Jack. Turn the kick drum up.
Well, I looked at him and caught him looking at me. I knew right then we were playing free in Oregon.
I think her best work is now. I love that she's willing to take chances in a different time and really still keep her music country and be very true to who she is, but kind of add a little rock flair.
So Loretta, the blue collar queen, is still rocking, still telling it like it is. But one queen quit 35 years ago and hasn't been seen in public since. She's the mystery queen who left country and then left music behind.
I was out chopping cotton and my brother was baling hay.
All her friends have no idea where she is. One of the great mysteries of music.
We stopped and walked back to the house to eat.
The song that made her name is a mystery too.
It's one of those records where you've never heard anything like it. I didn't know what was going on in the lyric. I had no idea, and it was it's creepy.
And then she said, I got some news this morning from Choctaw Ridge. Today, Billy Joe McAllister jumped off the Tallahatchie Bridge.
Happy Bridge. And she never would tell me what Bobby threw over the Tallahatchie Bridge.
When Bobby was a little girl in the Mississippi Delta, her grandma swapped a milk cow for a piano for her. At six, she could play by ear, and at seven, she wrote her first song, My Dog Sergeant is a Good Dog, immortalized years later on BBC TV.
Sergeant, 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 sergeant.
Born Roberta Streeter, she chose a stage name from a movie about a girl who left her country roots to become gentrified. Bobby became so gentrified that, unlike the other queens, she left the South and went on to college to study philosophy and music. But she also worked in Las Vegas in casinos and cabarets. It's always her childhood that rings through her songs. The daily life and colour, the values and hypocrisies of the Deep South.
Just outside of Delta country, where the bitter weeds growing wild.
There were like Br'er Rabbit stories, there were folk stories, they were just about her life.
Checking beads and drips, maybe written from a crackerjack box.
She played this three-quarter of the size guitar, which just gave it a lovely, almost ukulele sound. And very bluesy, very funky bluesy sound.
He said he saw a girl that looked a lot like you up on Choctaw Ridge. She and Billy Joe was throwing something up the tail at you.
In 1967, Ode to Billy Joe topped the US pop charts for 4 weeks, selling 3 million copies and made the charts here.
It's just incredibly evocative and cinematic. The amount of detail in it, a family sitting around a table, passing black eyed peas to each other and all these things that, you know, obviously you don't get in Croydon.
Was it an engagement ring that the couple threw from the bridge before Billy Joe jumped off himself, or a baby?
Originally, I think it was going to be a B-side because Capital got cold feet, thought it might be about abortion.
A lot of people think it was a baby, like she somehow was secretly pregnant and had this baby and then they threw it off the bridge, but she actually did say once that it wasn't a baby. But I don't know what it was. I'd like to know that.
Mama washed and combed and curled my hair and she painted my eyes and lips. Yeah. And then I stepped into a satin dancing dress. It was split on.
Fancy was another story song about a girl prostitute. It's also filled with shameful secrets and has often been covered by other singers.
I was 9 or 10 years old. It was, like, so controversial for me to sing, you know, at that age, but I did anyway.
Fancy is a great song because it's so sassy. You're singing as this woman, Fancy, who grew up poor, and then the mother turns her out into the street as a hooker.
Fancy, don't let me down. I thought that was one of her best records. Bobby's a good singer. She had her own sound. When you heard her on the radio, you knew who it was.
Her voice had a blues quality, which was rare in those days in a white singer. An enormous passion in the voice, an enormous drive.
Bobby became a star in Britain with her own TV show. It was one of the very first programmes to be shown in colour on the new BBC Two.
It was a folk country variety show. She wrote the show. She knew what she wanted. Very enthusiastic about everything. Very on all the time.
Glen Campbell was a guest on the show. He and Bobby started singing duets.
I bless the day I found you.
Their voices were just perfect together.
They liked her better in Mississippi than they liked me. I'm kidding.
Of course, everyone assumed they were doing more than singing together.
There were rumors of an affair with Bobby Gentry. Neither one of us ever initiated anything like that. It was like, I mean, she was, Bobby's my buddy.
What do you get when you fall in love? A guy with the...
Bobby married and divorced three times.
The problem is that I married too soon. Yes. My career had just started. I was scared to death that if I didn't do every interview and make every appearance, that I would wake up and it would have all gone away overnight.
With her last husband, she had a child.
I saw her just when the baby was born, which must have been maybe 20 years ago. And then she just disappeared.
One theory is that she bowed out because she couldn't get the control she wanted in the music business.
I applaud her for it. She just stepped down and says, I'm going to do what Bobby wants to do and not be led around by an agent or a manager.
This was where she lived all of her adult life. There's been no songs, there's been no music. This tremendous talent just stopped.
I've watched Mommy and Daddy, and if that's the way it's done, I don't wanna play.
Bobby was the mystery, but the next Queen's life was an open book.
She's had more than her share of unhappiness in her life.
A chaos of drink and pills, husbands and ex-husbands, violence and illness. Her songs charted it all. Speaking to women stuck in formica kitchens and loveless marriages, struggling to keep love alive, Tammy was their voice.
She had the beauty, the talent. She sang like a bird. I always felt kind of sorry for her.
And if that's the way it's done, I don't want to play.
Having been married five times, maybe she was telling herself there is someone out there that's perfect and right for her. And even though, you know, she wasn't having the greatest time trying to find that person, she didn't want to give up.
My daddy said goodbye.
Her father died when she was a baby.
She was always looking for that support that she would have gotten from her father. I believe that that's why she, you know, went from the men to men that she did.
Tammy married young, and by the time she was 20, had three children and was heading for a divorce.
And she was just ready to say, I'm out of here. Back in those days, you just didn't do that.
But the times, they were a-changing. The divorce rate was about to soar. More and more women were going out to work, and people were moving from country to town, just like Tammy. She got a job as a beautician, earning more money by singing in clubs at night.
She came to Nashville with babies in tow. She'd been on welfare. She had lived in projects. She'd been a beautician. She crawled over broken glass to get here.
Just follow the stairway to this lonely world of mine.
Tammy was tough, but it was just too tough all alone. She got herself a new husband and doorstep producer Billy Sherrill. Straight away, she had her first hit.
In apartment number 9.
She just looked so serious.
So very.
And I thought, wow, she's real different.
I turned on the radio, and they first started playing her. Boy, her voice stood out.
Really good country singer knows how to interpret a feeling and
knows how to interpret a lyric.
Loneliness surrounds me.
From that day on, I was always a fan of hers.
Her songs reflected the roller coaster of her relationships.
I worked on Divorce, D-I-V-O-R-C-E. Did I spell that right? I also worked on Stand By Your Man.
Sometimes it's hard to be a woman, giving all your love to just one.
I had a great feeling about that record when we did it, because she sang with so much soul. When she hits that high C sharp, you know, it's pretty thrilling. You're playing back there and she sails up and hits that note. It's emotion that you feel, and she conveyed emotion.
Stand by your man and show the world you love him. Keep giving all the love you can.
But it was 1968, and feminists weren't concerned about her high C sharp. They saw Stand By Your Man as an attack on everything they stood for.
Women didn't want to always be the ones that had to stand by their men every single time they did something wrong.
Women were kind of rebelling against that attitude, and that song fell in right at that moment. I heard Tammy say this 1,000 times. There's nothing in that song that says be a doormat. It simply says, stand by your man. He's weak, he's frail, he's going to make mistakes. You know, after all, he's just a man.
Every country woman knows what that's like, to try to stand by her husband no matter whether he's in the right or whether he's in the wrong, because that's your commitment as a wife. And so, to me, it was one of those songs like Loretta's songs. They were anthems for women of the time.
There were doormat songs, there's no question about it. She had one song called Don't Liberate Me, Love Me. But I still say Stand By Your Man is not a conservative song. It's about nurturing one another. A man could sing Stand By Your Woman.
I feel tears welling up, going deep inside like my heart's gone.
Then Tammy met another man she would do her best to stand by, country superstar George Jones. One night, the man she was meant to be singing with didn't turn up. The star of the show felt sorry for her.
My dad, out of the blue, invited her to come out on stage to sing the duet she was supposed to perform.
You're talking about Tammy Wynette.
Right.
Is she here?
She's here.
Put her to work.
Here we go.
All right. Well, I'm gonna get on the old turnpike and I'm gonna ride.
After a while, they started doing a lot more singing and recording together, and then eventually, I guess the story has written itself. They fell in love, and there you go.
Step by step, we walk the road together.
But she was still married. One night, George Jones came to dinner. Tammy's husband was shouting abuse at her.
It made my dad angry, and he stood up from the dinner table and knocked the dinner table over onto Dawn, and said that he wasn't going to speak to her like that, and that he was in love with her. And he said, I think that she's in love with me too, isn't that right? And she said, yes, I am. And so they got up and left.
And in each other's arms, we loved it away.
And then my dad and mom got together and eventually got married.
She had a lot of feeling, a lot of heart and a lot of soul. And once we started singing together, you know, it was just magic.
The trouble was, she couldn't live without George, but she couldn't live with him.
We're going hold on.
For her, meeting George Jones, it was just the best and the worst thing in her life. I mean, she just adored him, and he did her, but he had his alcohol problem and drug addiction.
Life can be rough.
And in the early 70s, that was when Mom was just beginning to start her drug addiction.
Tammy had serious health problems, which led to a lifelong addiction to painkillers. And once again, she was getting abuse.
He was very volatile. And she would not back down. She would, you know, take it, and she would give him his money's worth, too. It was very violent.
I think they fell in love with each other singing.
Just before we finish this song, I want to ask her.
When that got old, it was the fighting.
There's nothing wrong with that.
They wasn't getting along. I think they felt like both of them was captured then and trying to figure out how to get out of it.
Oh, come here. We need help.
Because they were both big, big stars there, and I just think you can share one mirror there.
Wedding rings there on his
face. Tammy stood by George till she could stand it no longer.
I was there at the breakup. It was the first time she'd ever gone on the road without George. And she said, I'm scared to go on the road without him. And we're like, you're kidding. She said, who'll come to see me? Who'll know who I am?
Another disastrous marriage followed. This one lasted only 44 days. People were beginning to laugh at Tammy.
And it's not something that I'm proud of, because I'm a firm believer in marriage, whether it,
you obviously
it seems
are.
That way or not.
For her, it was embarrassing. She felt like, I can't divorce again because of my fans.
When she married again, it was to George Ritchie. This time, it was to be until death.
We were married 20 years. And for the most part, it was absolutely beautiful.
She tried to make something of it because by then she was determined not to have another divorce.
She was always ill, and her drug dependency was getting worse.
Sometimes we would be on the bus and she would be hooked up to breathing machines and intravenous machines and unplug herself and go out and sing. The last tour to England, I remember calling everybody in the family, all the daughters, Richie, her husband, and begging and crying for them not to let Tammy go on the tour. I was convinced that she would come back in a coffin.
My husband and I were flying over to England. And I looked over and I saw this very, very fragile little old woman. Oh my God, I realized that was Tammy.
We brought her in for a show the BBC did in Birmingham, and they had to literally carry her on stage. She was very, very ill.
She was so fragile. That's the last time I ever saw her alive.
Precious memory.
Tammy was only 55 when she died. There were huge rows between George Ritchie and her daughters. The daughters had her body exhumed, alleging wrongful death. Even in death, she could not find peace. Her life was a tragedy, and it was also a triumph.
She was tagged as a spokesperson for the anti-feminist movement. But she was the one who was a career woman alone on the road. She was really very, very strong.
She certainly knew women could be the breadwinner and women could lead the world.
She really was one of the pioneers for women in our business.
Tammy stood for the ideal of the long-suffering wife, holding the home together. Her own life showed how hard that could be. But the teen queen was from a new generation. She was the bad girl, no longer the gingham-clad country sweetheart, but the wild child, never out of the headlines, the tabloid queen.
Tanya Tucker is a spunky little Texan at heart, and always will be. She's like the cat with nine lives.
Never just too much too soon. It's like trying to eat too much cake, I guess. If you eat too much cake, you're going to have to pay a penalty somewhere.
In those early years, I never really felt like I was poor. We had a trailer house that my dad enclosed and made it look like a house. I always had horses and animals. I kept losing my animals. They got run over. All these animals got getting run over. And I swore that if I ever got any money, if I ever became rich and famous, that I would live as far off the road as I possibly could.
So Tanya really did start out as trailer trash, trailing around after her father's jobs. But pretty soon the whole family would be following her job.
I told my dad at 9 years old, he asked me, he said, what do you want to do? You want to be a singer? Or do you want to just be normal, go to school, but like your friends? You let me know right now. Daddy said, now come, girl, we're heading down the road. I looked across the table at him and I said, I want to be a singer, Dad.
She never really had a childhood. She doesn't know anything different than to get up on that stage and sing her ass off. That Georgia sun was blood red
and going down. Her father was determined that she'd make it.
One night he said, Tanya, sing me this song. I sang it. He said, now that ain't you. You ain't got no feeling in that. And I said, well, Dad, I really want to go to sleep. I got school in the morning. He said, well, I'll tell you what. He said, if you're not going to sing it, he said, why don't you just go out there right now and chop them weeds. At times like these, a child of 10 never knows exactly what to say. So I said, fine. And I'm looking around like, you know, I'm scared, you know. Took me about an hour. He said, bring her in. So I went in there and I sang my heart out. And he said, okay, now you can go to bed. And going down. He wasn't going to give up till we got there. And he wanted to make sure that I was in that same place.
And that place would be Nashville.
She caused quite a stir when she came to Nashville. Nashville needs that every once in a while. It wasn't so bad. She's 41
and her daddy still calls her baby. Still a child, she had her first huge hit, Delta Dawn.
It kind of started leaking out that I was only 13.
It caused a scandal. In country music, girls were meant to be sweet and pure.
By the time Tanya was 15, she had sung of illegitimacy, crimes, rape. And that did create eyebrow raising in conservative Nashville. But she chose those songs. She turned down Happiest Girl in the Whole USA. She says, I'm not singing that, you know, at 13.
The other remarkable thing about little Tanya was her deep voice.
First time she sang, I said, her voice is lower than mine. I even asked one of the guys, does she smoke? She had this wonderful quality about her of rawness, of don't mess with me, I may be 14, but you lose.
No, it's just... No.
Tanya didn't take any crap off anybody. I remember seeing her in a club one time. She had a black eye and her red, you know, bloodshot, and I went, my God, Tanya, what happened to you? And she said, yeah, well, you should have seen the other girl.
My dad had taught me how to fight. You know, you get that nose, man, it ain't gonna do it. Hell with the hair, just get the nose. One little punch on that nose and they're gone, you know? Girls can't take it in the nose. Would you lay with me in a field of stone, if my needs were strong, would you lay with me? Should my lips grow dry, would you wet them, dear?
The uproar over Tanya's songs grew, with radio stations all over the South banning her. It didn't hurt sales. Her stage act and clothes became more and more sexy.
I think she was the rebel out of everyone. When they told her to go one way, she wanted to go the other.
What Tanya really did for country music was allow a female performer for the first time to be overtly sexual. Straight out of Texas and down around San
Antonio. She had this real chick meets Elvis vibe about her. She was a sex bomb, you know, and I'd never really seen that done with country music.
This was rags not to rhinestones, but to red spandex jumpsuits.
Women just didn't move in country music. I think I was probably one of the first ones to actually move. And it feels good on stage when I'm doing it, so let's just pour the coals on it.
Off stage, her life was hotting up too as she moved away from her parents. Okay, officer.
Living in L.A., having a great time. I had four cars, had a Porsche, and I had my own house out there, and I had a lot of friends.
And we all just sat in a circle, and we played songs, and we got high, and, you know, it was just, I got to see what a party girl she was.
I was like any other single white female American fun-loving girl. If I wasn't being hitting on, I was hitting on.
Then she hit on one that turned out to be big trouble, Glen Campbell. Nearly a decade after his duets with Bobby, he hooked up with Tanya. Their brawls and their binges on alcohol and cocaine really did hit the headlines.
Well, it's one southerner to another. How about the pleasure of this next song?
Well, certainly, Mr. Campbell. I'm just sitting out here on the front porch getting a vape.
I was 21, 22, and that probably didn't help. And he was 44 and thinking he's 22, and that probably didn't help.
Every night I hope and pray, a dream love will come my way.
Being involved in substance, we'll do it every time. I mean, that'll wreck a relationship every time.
In 1980, they sang the national anthem together at the Republican convention. Glenn says they'd just been higher than the notes they were singing.
Probably if we hadn't been so involved in all that, probably would have still been together today.
He says her infidelity ended the affair.
It was like it didn't make any difference if she was make it with one of my friends or one of the guys in the band. She lied so much she had to hire somebody to call her dog.
She says it was the violence.
A man is always going to be stronger than a woman. So therefore, I have to do it. I have to get him when he ain't looking, you know what I mean? And that can be dangerous.
Tanya soon caused another scandal by having children out of wedlock. But all the while, she's kept having country hits.
I'm not the tabloid queen anymore. But I think probably because of that, it's made me more like a household name. Pretty much Tanya Tucker's been pretty much across everybody's tongue at one time or another.
Jolene, 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 I'm begging of you, please don't take my man.
Tanya was wild and sexy and got slammed for it. But our final queen is clever enough to keep everything under control, her control, and does it with a smile that makes everyone love her. Unlike other queens, Dolly has no children or demanding husband. Maybe that's helped her become the biggest star of them all.
I think she's an immensely clever woman and very attractive. She's like flypaper to me. I can't take my eyes off her when she's in the room.
Your voice is soft like summer rain and I cannot compete with you, Jolene.
She's an incredible songwriter. She's underappreciated as a songwriter because of all the other things that you can focus on about her, her extraordinary appearance, her humour, her ability to act.
Dolly's worth so much money that she could buy Nashville.
Dolly is the most amazing woman I know for getting men to do what she wants them to do. She's been able to take that whole female thing. Would you know, do that for me, please?
Uh-oh.
No, and she's just run it down their throats.
Little sparrow.
Just like Loretta, Dolly was born dirt poor in the Kentucky mountains.
They've made an entire career out of being who they are. And that's a really difficult thing for a lot of people to do because they want to be somebody else. They want to put on a mask. They want to dress up.
Yet Dolly always did like to dress up. Her love of the makeover was there from the start.
We've always been really girly girls. And when we didn't have makeup, we would take burned matches and paint eyebrows on. And we would take berries from the mountains and paint our lips.
The big hair thing started early, too.
I would get up early and tease her hair and fix it in the back so it would be as big as she wanted it, because she always loved big hair.
She puts those wigs on and dresses up, but when she takes it all off, you know, she's just country's cornbread, just like the rest of us.
Dolly always has her tongue in her cheek.
We didn't have anything money could buy. In fact, we was pretty poor. Folks on welfare used to bring us stuff.
My earliest memory of Dolly would be of her laughing at me because she always had such a great sense of humor.
Miss Parton,
hi.
You always look so beautiful. Do you have any secrets to give us?
Clean living.
It's
Avoid clean living at all costs.
Shock value has always been real important to Dolly.
When they were growing up, there was music all around.
My mother would sing us these beautiful old Irish laments, and I'd cry, and, you know, it was like watching a movie or something. When Daddy would drink on the weekends, he would come home, you know, three sheets to the wind, and he would play the banjo and buck dance and all that, so we didn't know any other way.
At 10, Dolly got her first chance to sing on the radio.
Give me a word, give me a sign. Show me where to look and tell me what will I find.
She knew then that she wanted to be a star and worked at it. This little girl paid her dues.
Lay me on the ground, fly me in the sky. Show me where
I signed Dolly Parton when she was 14 years old. Dolly and her uncle Bill Owens would come back and forth from her home up there in East Tennessee. They didn't have any money, of course. Bill would sleep in his car, and Dolly would stay for $2 a night at the YWCA.
I believe she was still in high school. She had this tiny little voice. It was haunting. And she was doing some songs she had written, and they were so good.
You could tell that one day she was going to happen, and it didn't take too many years after that she really did.
The day she left high school, Dolly moved to Nashville for good. The very next year, she had a number one hit.
Don't try to cry your way out of this. Don't try to lie.
When we did Dumb Blonde, Dolly was fresh from the mountains. She was obviously very bright. It's proven she's certainly not a dumb blonde.
Just because I'm blonde, don't think I'm dumb. Cause this dumb blonde ain't nobody's fool.
And she's still got the same squeal she had when she was in high school.
That's enough of that.
And she was still feisty, just like she is now.
When you left, you thought I'd sit and you thought I'd wait and you thought I'd cry. You called me a dumb blonde.
Right now I want to call out a little gal here. That
in 1967, country star Porter Wagoner spotted her.
Records. I haven't called you out yet. Wait just a minute there, kiddo.
For the next 7 years, she was his partner on his TV show.
It's my time to cry, yeah. It's my time to cry, oh. It's my turn to cry, mm. It's my time. So pray.
This was the most fruitful time for her own writing. The songs just poured out of her.
Back through the years, I go wandering once again. Back to the seasons of my youth. I recall a box of rags that someone gave us.
I think Dolly's best material was the stuff that she really wrote from the heart back in the early 70s.
There were rags of many colors.
Songs that are, to me, her richest poetry. She had no collaboration with other people to write all these great songs.
Mama sewed the rags together, so in every piece with love, she made my coat of many colors.
Coat of Many Colors is my favorite of anything that she's ever done.
In my coat of many colors, well, I hurried off to school just to find the others laughing and making fun of me and my coat of many colors that Mama made for me.
It really appealed to me. Your parents didn't have enough money to buy you new clothes, so they patched up the ones that you had, and the other kids at the school all laughing and stuff. Well, my early life was a bit like that, you know, a bit patched up.
And oh, I couldn't understand it, 'cause I felt I was rich.
Dolly can be funny. At the same time, she can write The Coat of Many Colors, and you realize that she's as deep as John Lennon ever tried to be. But she's much prettier than he is, that's for sure.
The thing I like about Dolly, really, is that her songs do have a story and have a background, and they're from a kind of real place as opposed to just rhyming.
Jolene, 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 I'm begging of you, please don't take my man. Jolene,
they're such real songs and such honest songs, you know. And I think that I'd like to hear some more of those because I think we've gotten away from that in Nashville. That's what made us different from the whole world.
From the very start, Dolly looked back to the childhood home she'd left behind.
There was a boy who loved me dearly, but I broke his heart.
She made country into a myth, and then she left it behind too.
My Blue Ridge Mountain boy. Tumble out of bed and I stumble to the kitchen, pour myself a cup of ambition.
With great difficulty, Dolly got away from the Porter Wagoner show. Her music went pop, and she headed for Hollywood.
Dolly always had the ability to plan ahead while she's charming you. Working 9 to 5,
what a way to make a living. Country music followed Dolly into the mainstream, at a price. The reign of the country queens was coming to an end. Dolly's business career took off. She became a myth in her own right.
She said, they don't call it show art, they call it show business. Let's treat it like a business. Dolly has had more top 10 hit records than any other woman in country music, by far. And has become bigger than country music, bigger than Nashville.
Dolly has her very own theme park, Dollywood.
My daughter's more interested in going to Dollywood than she is at Disneyland. She's like, can we meet her? She's a Dolly Parton obsessive fan. She keeps asking me, Mommy, what does she look like? Tell me again. And we go through the big blonde hair, enormous breasts.
In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Having conquered the world, Dolly has returned to her musical roots.
By and by.
The bluegrass albums are just outstanding. And Little Sparrow and stuff, those albums. Oh my God. And I asked her once, I said, how do you get all your songs ready for an album? She said, I go to a house I've got in Kentucky. And it's a wooden house, it's not great. And she fasts for a week or so, and then she writes. And she's, that seems to do the trick for her. She seems to get back to where she belongs that way, which is a peculiar way to do it. But I always knew she was a lot more complicated than she lets you think she is.
The golden age for the country queens is over. The decades when what they did and said changed the world, when they were adventurers on the road to independence, are no more. But unlike most pop stars, queens of country have long careers and loyal audiences. Those who died too young still sell millions, and the queens who survived still sing.
Love is in the water, love is in the air. Show me where to go.